Well, good morning again, everyone. I'll go ahead and tell you now that the vote passed.
I will not trust in my way. nor will my sword save me, but you have saved us from the hand of And you have put to shame those who hate us. God, we have boasted all day long, and we will give thanks to your name forever. You know, again, the principles for us, through numerous wars, including two world wars, God has protected this nation. And we, for such a long time, were very appreciative of God for his mercy. I think we'd all agree, though, that something has changed. Something has drastically changed in our nation in recent years. Our nation has become to dishonor God in so many ways. Much like the days of the psalmist, because we take a turn right in the middle of this psalm. The psalmist begins to say in verse 9, Yet you have rejected us, God, and you have brought us to dishonor. You do not go out with our armies any longer. And you cause us to turn back from the adversary. We can't even meet our enemies anymore. We're having to turn back from them. And those who hate us have kept us spoiled for themselves. You give us a sheep to be. Has scattered us among the nations to sell your people cheaply. And have not profited by their sale. You make us a reproach to our neighbors, a scoffing and a derision to those around us. You make us a byword among the nations and a laughing stock among the people. Sounds a lot like our nation today, doesn't it? And then it goes on to talk about cry of the people. When the people begin to cry out to God, verse 17. And this has come upon us, but we have not forgotten it. But we have not dealt falsely with your covenant. Our heart has not turned back, and our steps have not deviated from your way. Yet you have thrust us in a place of jackals and covered us with the shadow of death. If we have forgotten the name of our God, or extended our hand to a strange God, would not God strike us out? For he knows the secrets of the heart, but for your sake we are killed all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Rouse yourself. Why do you sleep, O Lord? Awake and do not reject us forever. Why do you hide your face and forget our affliction and our oppression? For our soul is compared to the dust, and our body brings to the earth. Rise up and your help and redeem us for the sake of your loving kindness. I read that, my heart was just spiritually great concern for our future as a nation and for God's church in America. And I was struck by the fact that these verses were written about a nation that had once walked with God. I mean, really walked closely with their God. But then something happened. That nation began to stray from God. And they didn't just stray away from God, they strayed into something else. Something called idolatry. They begin to worship other gods. And we don't put up little statues, there are not too much in America today to worship, but we have gods. We have other gods that we worship. And this is what they began to do. And the result of all this was God dealt with them specifically. And though I started this. Preach on John 6 this morning. I was impressed by the need to speak to this subject without delay. Perhaps, I mean, this thing just kind of developed. I thought out of nowhere, but I know it wasn't out of nowhere. Perhaps three things, probably actually four, played a role in my decision to stray away from John this morning. The first one was I read this psalm, but given us prophets, and he's given the church a pastor, teachers, and so forth. So I think he's very serious to do as well. But here's what he told Ezekiel to do, to tell, to go and tell the people about this judgment to come, and what would happen if he did, and what would happen if he did. And we read this in Ezekiel 3:16. At the end of 7 days, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Son of man, I have appointed you a watchman to the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, warn them from me. And when I say to the wicked, 'You will surely die,' and you do not warn him or speak out to warn the wicked from his wicked way that he may live, that wicked man shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require of your hand." Verse 19, "Yet if you have warned the wicked, he does not turn from his wickedness or from his wicked way, he shall die in his iniquity, but you have delivered yourself. Again, when a righteous man turns away from his righteousness and commits iniquity, so he's gone from the wicked to the righteous man. And I place an obstacle before him, he will die, and since you have not warned him, he shall die in his sin, and his righteous deeds which he has done shall not be remembered, but his blood I will require of your hand." However, if you have warned the righteous man that the righteous should not sin, and he does not sin, he shall surely live because he took warning, and you have delivered yourself. And it's our job to, not just mine, but ours, to warn the nation in which we live, both the wicked and the righteous. There's a second reason I felt so inspired and pressed upon to tackle this subject today. And that has to do with how Don and I have been spending some of our evenings lately. We've been watching YouTube. I know some of you say, "Oh, I think that's a bad thing. It's got bad, but it's got good too. It's not different than anything else on the internet. Again, it's good, bad, and different. But for us, it's been a present shift. If we choose right. I watch a lot of woodworking shows to find out shortcuts and how to do this and how to do that. There's a lot of how-tos to help you repair your own stuff and not have to pay someone else. There's documentaries, there's news, there's music, there's TV shows, especially the old ones that we can watch when they were good and clean and fun. There's history. There's some really good Christian movies. If y'all want to find Christian movies, you can go to YouTube and find them. And there's lots of preaching. We've got to find lots of preaching. This is what I've been more than anything else from YouTube. There are lots of church services. Okay? Even Bluff Creek. We have a weekly prayer in church. But lately, we've been tuning in, just became serious. And we've been tuning in to mostly with local churches. Your services to see what's available in our area to those who are seeking a place where they can find God and hear His unchanging truth through solid biblical preaching. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm talking local stuff. You know, we think about those, you know, in California, those big churches, and we hear all about what they're doing and the heresy and so forth. But I'm going to be honest with you. We've been looking at local churches, and I've walked away about my people who are Christians. Even how I'm up here. Most of what I've witnessed has left me somewhere between discouraged and disturbed. I watched one this morning. God got another word for me. I was sad. This was a church in Western Satan. A bad church. I'm not going to tell you what it was all about. I'm not going to tell you this morning, but it was appalling. Not only what I heard, but what I didn't. For 30 minutes that is listening to me. Where is God? Where is Jesus? Where are we? Where is he? It has made fiery appointments to have met with God through three times almost constantly. But it was totally on a different. He had a different focus for me. That church was all connected. And I was a father. This is where some of our pulpits have gone. Even our local ones. I never imagined a day when finding a church that preached the Bible unapologetically would be so hard. I mean, I thought that was the norm. But I'm going to tell you something. You do the research, you're going to find out it is not the norm. It's not the norm anymore. Even in small churches. And I thought about that, and I thought, there's no wonder to me that God took some verses like we're about to read in the Bible. It's like God knew what would be the condition of his church in these latter days. And so we read things like this in 1 Timothy 5:17-18. The elders, speaking of pastors, who rule well are to be considered worthy of double honor, especially those who work hard at teaching and preaching. It's like, obviously, God knew this is not going to be the norm any longer in those last days. For the scripture says, you shall not muzzle the ox while it's threshing, and the labor is worthy of his wages. And again, we bring this in 2 Thessalonians 5. But we request of you, brethren, that you appreciate those who diligently labor among you and have a charge over you in the Lord. What's this? To give you instruction. Obviously, he's talking about solid, biblical instruction that you esteem and very highly loved because of the work with peaceable. And in Hebrews 13, remember those who led you, what's this? Who spoke nothing out of the garbage, but the word of God to you. Consider the result of the conduct of the faith of faith. Obey your leaders, verse 17 says, for they keep watch over your souls as those who are given account. We just read that with Ezekiel. God said he was given account if he didn't want to. And so God knew that where we were going to be. And obviously, Paul did too, because the next page of your bulletin. In the longer passage. And this is what Paul told his church even way back then. I mean, you know, things always seem to get worse and stuff better. And they were dealing with this way back then. Now behold, verse 20 says, behold, I know that all of you among whom I went about preaching the kingdom will no longer see my face. He's about to leave. Therefore I testify to you this day, I'm innocent of the blood of all men. You know why I just say that? Because he knew he had preached the solid gospel of Jesus Christ, the solid word of God. He says, for I did not shrink from the plan to you, the whole purpose of God, be on guard for yourselves, for all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit makes overseers. He's talking to the other pastors here. To shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. This is a very serious thing. Something so serious that Jesus died for it. And I know that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. From your own selves men will arise, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after them. They will be on the alert. Remembering day and night, for a period of 3 years, I did not cease to admonish each one with conviction. And then there's a third reason I felt inspired to be here with John this morning to teach this message. And this simply is, if we all know this, if you're paying attention at all, you know this is the condition of our nation. It's fairly rapid decline from righteousness and holiness and godliness that we're now witnessing in recent times. And now we've even crossed the threshold now into becoming, perhaps, among the 7 most godless nations on this planet. When you look at those things that are so important to God, how we, as a nation, have dismissed God, how we blasphemed God in so many ways. I remember years ago, Billy Graham's wife, Miss Ruth, was quoted as saying that if God doesn't judge America's sins, you're going to have to apologize. time in your life. That was way back then. I'm going to tell you, I'm not that bold. I'm not going to tell God what he's got to do. But you know what she was saying? I am very concerned that we may be on the cusp of a great judgment from God upon my nation. And I strongly felt the need to share my concerns with my flock this morning in the form of a warning. Because when we read the Word of God and we see what God did to other nations who have so broken his laws and so blatantly rejected his will, we need to see that and apply that to us by principle. So this message was born out of, number one, what I read from the Bible, what I read in the book of Psalms, or what I read in the book of Ezekiel, how God just spoke about those things. It also came from what I've seen. These preachers, even the local preachers, the preachers of faith, were still being preaching the Word. It's so many, not all of them. I watched another one this morning. I tuned in every seven to this one, that he is just straight up solid Bible. And I love to hear the great when they come on after what I'm talking about. But it's different. So I'm not talking about all preachers by any means, but about what I've seen in so many of our preachers now. And fairly about what I know. What I know about the rebellion of our nation against our God. God who gave us this nation, blessed us, and gave us everything we have since then. This is actually a fourth reason. What is really truly concerns me? That we could be on the brink of severe judgment from God because of what I say. Just in the recent last 2 weeks, I was heard a petition of worship about how our national leadership has begun to turn our backs on God's nation of Israel. As a nation, our leadership and doing things that are causing many of the Jewish community to be hurt, killed. And I'm not talking about what happens over there, what happens here. It's almost giving a license to people to hate people from Israel. We're doing it. Our nation is doing it. I was afraid this was going to happen, and now it's happening. And the truth is, God promised Abraham that there would be blessed for those who blessed that nation that Abraham was the father. And meanwhile, Israel has the promises of preservation. Through history, they've tried to eliminate that nation, and God has always preserved it. Because it began with Israel. It's going to end with Israel. And so there's been a promise to preserve and bless that nation. They've had that promise, but guess what? The United States of America has not. God has never promised to preserve it. God has never promised even to bless us, though he has so much. Here's what I want you to know, because there's nobody that's more patriotic and loves our nation more than I do. I've had to come to a realization in this fact that in the grand scheme of things, the United States is more than the world. When you look at all the nations of the world, and all the time that they've been here and haven't been here and so forth. We just have blimp on the scope of history, especially if we're not serving the God who gave this nation to us. And God doesn't owe this nation a thing. If we've done what we're about to see, is we've read Ezekiel, we've committed spiritual adultery. And I want you to see just how serious this is. And so God begins to reveal to Ezekiel about the judgment that's going to come. And in chapter 4 and 5, God does mention prophets, and I'm glad he doesn't do the pastors anymore. But he wanted Ezekiel to illustrate what was coming in some pretty graphic ways. Don't read about those things. I just want to say that to say that after that, God gave Ezekiel a message to preach. I want you to compare between the pre-judged nation of Judah, before the judgment happened, and our nation today. If we read some of these verses, chapter 5, verse 5, we read this. The message that God gave to Ezekiel. Thus says the Lord God, this is Jerusalem. I set her at the center of the nation with lands around it. But she has rebelled against my ordinances more wickedly than the nations and against my statutes more than the lands who surround her. For they have rejected my ordinances and have not walked in my statutes. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because you have more turmoil than the nations which surround you, and have not walked in my statutes, nor observed the ordinances of the nations which surround you, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against you, and I will execute judgment upon you in the summit of the nations. Think about this for a moment. And if that's not enough, then God begins to reveal the terrifying details of all these calamities that are going to come upon this nation. And that all continues through chapter 6 and chapter 7. But I want you to hone in with me on one particular verse that really enlightens us about the pain of rejection that God is feeling in his heart, your knowledge. This is chapter 6, verse 9. Read with me now. God says, and then those of you who escape will remember me among the nations to which they will be carried captive. How I have been hurt by their adulterous hearts, which turned away from me, and by their eyes, which played the harlot after their idols. And they will loathe themselves in their own sight for the evils which they have committed, for all their in this way, to someone that you know, maybe that you barely know, who fits you in some way, you can probably say that. That's what people do. But I'm going to tell you something. It's your thoughts to make it guilty. That is such a blatant sin. That's not what it is. It's just that the way. Devastating. That's what God is saying right here. This is devastating to me what you have done. You are my bride. You are my wife. You are the one that I love so much. And you have done this to me with other nations. Played the harlot. You committed adultery. It's not only hurt, but it's still anger. If they would do this. Then comes a very intentional phrase that God is going to use in these passages again and again and again in these judgment passages. Here's what it will look like. There will even be fewer there. They will know that I am the Lord. Look with me in chapter 6, verse 10. Then they will know that I am the Lord. If we back up to verse 7, you will know that I am the Lord. You go down to verse 13, and you will know that I am the Lord. Over to verse 14, at the end of the verse, thus they will know that I am the Lord. Verse 7, in chapter 7, verse 4, then you will know that I am the Lord. Verse 9, while you know that I am the Lord, that's doing this fight here. God is saying over and over and over, when I'm finished doing knowing what I'm going to do to you, you're going to know that I'm the Lord. You've been worshiping all these other gods and these other idols. I'm going to tell you something. I'm the one true God, and you're about to find out. It's a very what God is doing, He is assuring them that if calamities come upon you, they're not by coincidence. They are by a much expected God. If you're like me, it's not my place where I can go. And I wonder, why is this so much for me? God, why do you take this? Why do you do this? And the answer is patience. God's a patient God. Here's what we read in 2 Timothy. The Lord is not slow about His promise, as some count slowness, but He's patient toward you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Now, I'm going to tell you something. When the Bible says that God is patient, it does not mean that God forgets to judge. It just means He puts it off as long as He possibly can, hoping people will come to repentance. But He promises it'll come, and there's a great example right here in Ezekiel where God over and over says, they're going to know that I am the Lord. I think you'll all agree. So we've been told all our lives that America's the greatest nation ever existed. Right? But what that does for us is it creates a mindset that the U.S. will always exist. It will always be here. I mean, we're a huge power. We're greatly wealthy. Some even claim to find America is a prophecy. Boy, they have to stretch a lot of things to get that to happen. Because I'm going to tell you something. An honest reading of Scripture, there is no such claims about America in the Bible. In prophecy. You have to go down some rabbit trails to get that to happen. There's absolutely no evidence that the United States of America will even be in play at all at the end times. It's only speculation or assumption. So please don't assume that the United States is too great to disappear. Many an empire has made that same erroneous assumption. He said, Pastor Kenny, what all those Old Testament empires, God does judge nations on this side of the cross. Really? Look with me in Matthew 5. But when the Son of Man comes in glory, all the angels with Him will sit on His throne, and all the nations will be gathered before Him. He's going to separate them one from another. And you say, well, Pastor, that's just the end time stuff. Okay, so, he still doesn't do that today, does he? I mean, there's no judgments between the cross and the end of time, really? I did a little research this week. You know what? I was shocked to learn that there have been hundreds, I didn't even count them all, but hundreds of once sovereign states, dynasties, empires in the past 2,000 years between the cross and man. They no longer exist today. The average length of an empire is about 250. The United States has the second longest surviving constitution. It's 235 years old. The empire that you're probably most familiar with would be the Roman Empire. Remember that? That's the empire we learned about in the book of Daniel, the statue of Nebuchadnezzar saw, and Rome was the legs of iron, and his feet mixed with iron. See, the Roman Empire was first to the one that existed during Jesus' ministry on the earth. You know what's interesting is, how do you know what caused the collapse of the Roman Empire? Here's what happened. It imploded. Over time, according to some historians, it was due to the invasion of barbarians coming across their borders from several, many different countries. They're listed. And it changed everything. It was a time called the migration period, Roman history. They also initiated some major cultural and political transformations. Y'all pay attention. They also gave another reason. It was a general rejection of previous traditions and values. And still another reason was the disease that came into that empire and caused the people to be displaced. Did anybody say 2024 is not special for you? The very things that brought Rome down really were in the Roman Empire. We need to pick up the pieces on it. We need to read some history. We've got to be living right now under the greatest threat of collapse since the founding of this great nation. We are smothered in unsustainable. I was looking at like 2004, we had $3 trillion. Our politicians are still piling on more debt. We've opened up our borders to anyone and everyone who decides to come in, totally unvetted. We know through our news organizations that terrorists have been crossing our border unchecked. We know that diseases have been coming in unchecked. Our military readiness is at a historic low in many ways. Our leadership, our national leadership, is extremely weak throughout the world. The world is laughing at us. Our economy is in shambles. Our politicians are resolved to not do anything to correct the inconsistency. We are as divided as we have been since the Civil War. Our media lies to us at every turn. When they're not lying, they're covering up for those who are lying. Our law enforcement has been restrained so much that it's collapsing, mostly by design. Our educational institutions, especially higher education, have become nothing more than indoctrination. The number of true, bold, Bible-preaching pastors is rapidly decreasing. As a nation, we have been killing off the next generation, scouting them, and continue to do so without apology, even celebrate the murder of babies in the womb. We've allowed illegal drugs to pass through our borders to kill off our youth. if that doesn't do it, we'll corrupt their minds with some of the greatest intellectual garbage that a nation has ever produced. And all that, by many estimations, we could have right now. We blaspheme God with all of our idols. And more people are feeling empowered to openly, proudly mock God and profane the name of Jesus Christ without any measure of restraint. And we have to ask ourselves three vital questions. Number one, could we possibly be more primed for a national collapse than we are right now? Number two, could we possibly become more right for the judgment of Almighty God if we are? I'm not saying that God will get around it, but we should be able to do it. Because compared to the nation's death, that's a great moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, and you, son of man, thus says the Lord God to the land of Israel, the end is coming on the four corners of the land. Now the end is on the bottom. And remember, this is written before that came. Now the end is upon you, and I will send my anger against you. I will judge you according to your ways, to bring all your abominations upon you. Listen to that. I will judge you according to your ways. God says, it's a wonder if God is a fair judge. Absolutely, he's a fair judge. He judges us according to the things we do, according to our ways. For my eyes, verse 4, will have no pity on you. You know when the pity was? You know when God had pity? When he sent Jesus from heaven to earth to come and die on the cross. Because we were in such a terrible position that we could never have a relationship with God unless Jesus did this. He had pity on us. He did what he needed to do for us. And now in this place that we don't know that God. He says, I will not have pity on you, nor will I spare you. But I will bring your ways upon you, and your abominations will be upon you, and you will know that I am the Lord. Thus says the Lord God, a disaster, a unique disaster. Behold, it's come. You know, we look at things like tornadoes, hurricanes, floods, things like that. We say, well, probably judge for the God. You know what? God is saying here, more likely that was an accident. God says, when I deal with you, it's going to be a disaster. And you'll know that I am not going to be. What's this? The end is coming. The end has come. Here's what I want you to know about this. It hasn't come yet. This is still warning time. Ezekiel is telling the people that this is going to come, folks. And so God says, the end is coming. Then he says, you know why? how I say one thing. Because what God says is a done deal. Alright? Maybe the story hasn't fallen yet, but it's as good as gold because God says it will. First step, your business can run you over here for that story. The time has come, the day is near. The people are ready to enjoy the shouting of the mountain. Now it's going to pour out the wrath. Here's what I want you to see one more time. These are God's covenant people. But they continually cause the mercies of God in His presence. And the result? Total destruction. God had given a plan through the prophet Isaiah even long before this. Before His great judgment of Judah, we read about that in Isaiah 66. He says, "On your walls, Jerusalem, I have appointed watchmen." And they say, "Ezekiel, the watchman. I don't know what the watchman was, but why is he the one that we're looking for trouble so they can warn everybody? I have appointed watchmen all day and night. They will never keep silent. They say something, they're going to let everybody in the city know. This is coming. Get ready. Wake up." And he goes on to say, "You who remind the Lord, take no rest for yourselves." In other words, they're going to be on the ground to rest. They're not sleeping up there. They're watching. They're going to be warning. They're going to be loud. They're going to be shouting. But you know what happened? Obviously, they stopped watching. God told them this is the way to do it. And they stopped watching. They became silent. They began to rest. What's the solution for our great dilemma? Well, first of all, it's to watch. It's to have a rest. You'll be kind of a rest. But we're on the other side. And it's to have a rest. You know, Jesus left us a great rest. And why? You go and you use your mouth, you use your words to warn people about a place called hell. Imagine how much different our nation would be today had the church been all in on evangelism, on winning our neighbors and our family members and our co-workers and our schoolmates and strangers and everybody else. How different. You know, it's not the Christians that are running around out there killing people and hurting people and burning down buildings and all the other things. What is doing so many more Christians? We stand with them. We're in the watchman. But we became silent. We started resting. But our solution is to proclaim the gospel to the lost and dying wretched world. And then pray that God will spare us. if God delivered Israel after all those years of exile, because of his promises to Abraham about Israel. But hear me loud and clear, church, we're not Israel. We're America. God's made no promises. And obviously, the best way to be ready when the judgment comes is to be saved. So, as we close this morning, I want you, if anybody else is listening, to come back tonight. Here is a judgment coming. It may not be a national judgment. I don't know. I can't say that. I would not be surprised if it did. For anybody that's not in Christ, you still in your sins. And you will be judged for those, and it will be an eternal judgment. And there is a place called hell. And that's where you'll spend all the time. Never completely die, but die all the time. It will not be a place of a big part. All the donkey bones get together and all the time with the promise of all this place filled with a donkey full of Christians. All of that to be avoided because of what Jesus did when he went to that cross and said, I'll take all of that to be avoided on the cross if we just turn back. My Savior. Because I know that the only way I'm going to ever be able to stand before a holy God is in holy Christ. Everybody, this has been a hard message to preach, a hard message to hear. Lord, you did our help in any way, shape, or form, believe in the Old Testament, about all this judgment, all these things on your people, just to give us a history lesson. Lord, you have protected your word throughout the centuries so that we can keep it. You give it to us for a reason, for your people. But look, you know, this was about Israel, but the principles apply to this as well. The nation that we serve is the nation that we serve. That you work in heritage to bring us into existence. And we began so well by our founding fathers. Use your word to build us a foundation. Some of the folks that started this nation built universities that were solely for the propagation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you.